Okay, so welcome back to Applied Mathematical Finance, Computational Finance. And we are in a section on interest rate products. So we did the linear products, so the ones which we could value without actually a model. And then we introduced some nonlinear products. So where we have nonlinearities, say for example, a maximum function, like a call option in the payoff. And today I would like to discuss models to value these simple European options. And you see that we will basically do the Black-Scholes model, the Bachelier model, so the classic stuff. Yeah? But now we do the classic stuff for interest rates. And it's maybe nice to see this because we will use a little bit the change of numeraire or the choice of numeraire as an important tool. So something that you are not so aware of when you look at Black-Scholes model for a stock. So it's good to repeat this, and this technique will later be important. And for that reason, we did a small repetition of the Black-Scholes model. And as part of this repetition here, there was a small sketch of the steps which we do. Yeah, so we have some payoff function, yeah, which you see here, which we would like to value using the universal pricing theorem. And the steps that we do are that we choose a numeraire. Then we move through the equivalent martingale measure, where we do this move in a very elegant way because we know that the property of being a martingale under a measure is just that the drift is zero. And Gersanov tells us that moving to the equivalent martingale measure just changes the drift, so we can just focus on the drift. Then the next step was that we then derive the distribution of our underlying or all the stuff that appears here in the expectation. Okay, so there was now the derivation where we do all these steps, yeah, moving to the measure, writing the process under the equivalent martingale measure, looking at the distribution, and then calculating the integral, yeah, which is maybe a little bit cumbersome calculation. And in the end, we have the Black-Scholes formula, which looked like that. So that's the classic Black-Scholes formula for a call option on a stock S, as following a log normal process, the Black-Scholes model. And a little bit the formula looks not so nice, yeah, not so natural, because you have here these coefficients, you have here in front the initial value of S, but then here you have an e to the minus rtk. So this somewhat involves a parameter that is related to the model, the interest rate, and a parameter that is related to the financial product, the strike rate. And then we have here this complicated expression for the d plus minus. So the things that occur here in the cumulative distribution function, in the distribution function of the normal distribution. But actually, if you go back to the derivation, you can make this Black-Scholes formula looking a little bit nicer. And also, you can abstract the derivation from the fact that we are actually looking at a model for a stock. And that was my last part in the last session. So we had some kind of generalized Black-Scholes formula. And let's continue at this point, because we will then see how this carries over to interest rates. So you can actually first reformulate the formula by introducing here this M. So this M is a little bit like our numeraire. Okay, so what was our numeraire? Our numeraire in the derivation of the Black-Scholes model was the B, yeah, so B of little t is exponential RT. So that was our numerator in the Black-Scholes model. And now if you take a look, you see that M of T is just our numerator renormalized by B of capital T. So that has the nice effect that M of capital T is equal to one. Yeah, so this looks like a zero Cooper bond. So it is a zero Cooper bond with maturity in capital T. So it is associated with the payment date. So it's associated with at what time do I pay what? I pay one unit, or I pay in units of one currency at time capital T. So you see that this here is somehow encoding the payment. Yeah, and then a note that M of zero is just an e to the minus RT. So you see here that M of zero is an e to the minus R capital T. So this is the guy that appeared in front of the K in our Black-Scholes formula. You see here, there is the e to the minus RT. So this is our M of zero. So if I move this out here of this bracket, of course, then I have to write here the S zero that was in front of this as S of zero divided by M of zero. So F of zero is just S of zero divided by M of zero. And now you see that this is exactly the same as we had on the other slide for the Black-Scholes formula. It's S of zero, which is this S of zero here. Yeah, if you just cancel the M, multiplied with phi of t plus minus k times e to the minus rt multiplied with phi of t minus. So, and this F, I now define this F as the other object as a stochastic process. It's the stochastic process S divided by M. And if you go back now to the derivation of the Black-Scholes formula, you see that the only thing we needed was that we can choose M as a numerator. So if you choose B as a numerator or M as a numerator, it doesn't make a difference. It's just a different scaling, a different amount where you start with. If we choose M as a numerator, then F is a martingale. Yeah? So F is my underline, and we have the fact that F is a QM martingale. So there was nothing else needed, and F follows a log normal process. So we had a DF equals a zero DT plus a sigma F DW. Okay, so let's go back to the proof. Where was that? Yeah, where was this appearing? That was actually here in the derivation of this drift property. So this here is our F of T in the new notation. So actually it's not the F because the B is not the M. There is a scaling factor, but the constant doesn't matter. Yeah. And then you see that here we have this F of T times sigma DW. Okay, and for our F, this guy is zero, so that determined the move to the equivalent martingale measure. So you see that all these aspects are in there. And you can immediately say that you have the Black-Scholes formula now in a very handy different form. So last ingredients, what is our payoff? So instead of saying we pay S minus K, the maximum of this and zero, I could also now just say I pay maximum of F of T minus K and zero times M of T. Yeah? And M of T is now encoding here this one unit of currency. I pay that many units of currency at time capital of T, and F of T is a unit less amount, yeah, a ratio. So you can rewrite this in this red form here because M of capital T is just one, and you see that then F of capital T is just equal to S of capital T. Okay, so first of all, this Black-Scholes formula here looks much nicer. Yeah, it has much more symmetry. It's easier to remember. Yeah, it's also nice to remember because here the coefficient that is here in front and here in front correspond exactly to what is inside this maximum function. And funny thing, if you write here in the d plus minus not s divided by k, where s contains this e to the r t, yeah. So instead, if you write the f divided by k, so actually exactly the ratio of the coefficients here, then this parameter r that was here in between also vanishes. So also the d plus minus is far easier to remember. Yeah? So actually, I just memorized the Black-Scholes formula in this form. It's much nicer. And suddenly you see that it has nothing to do with an option on a stock. It has something to do with an option on an object that is a martingale under a certain measure, where with the payment is in units of the numerator. And now we move to the interest rate case. So models for European options on interest rates. And as a first look, let's discuss the valuation of an option on a caplet. So what is the good choice of the numerator and which object is a martingale maybe under that numerator? Okay, so the Black model for a caplet. So maybe just copy here the definition of our payoff. So what we pay is we pay in time t2. And what we pay is assume we pay one unit of currency. Times the maximum of the interest rate. Let's call the interest rate L1. So that's the interest rate for the period from T1 to T2. It is fixed at the beginning of the period minus K and zero multiplied with the period length T2 minus T1. So this is paid in T2. So it's a nonlinear function. So I need a model for the object, for the random variable that appears here. And I assume now the Black model, which assumes a log normal dynamic for this object. Yeah? So this is the Black-Scholes model, say for L1. So my L1 is the interest rate for the period from T1 to T2. So here we have the payoff, and first observation, my object that occurs here, so my L1, yeah, if I look up the definition, yeah, then L1 multiplied with the period length is the bond at the beginning of the period divided by the bond of the end of the period minus one. So you can rewrite this as PT1 minus PT2 divided by PT2. And there is a nice effect. Yeah? So we had this before. If I choose PT2 as my numerator, Then this is the ratio of a traded asset, the portfolio, long, short of this, these two zero coupon bonds, and the numerator. So this is a martingale under the measure where I choose PT2 as numerator. So this is a QPT2 martingale. So we already are in the situation that I have sketched before. I have an option on an object, and this object is a martingale under a certain numerator. And now comes a coincidence. Yeah. So actually it is that this product is paying something in a very natural way, because this guy here is not only appearing here in the index, this guy is also appearing in the payment date. So we pay in units of PT2. So you could say that here this one unit of currency is actually the zero coupon bond that matures in T2, of course, observed at the payment date. So this is our numerator at the payment date. Okay, so the question is, what is the natural choice of the numerator? And our natural choice of the numerator is the zero coupon bond that pays one unit at T2. So we choose the T2 bond under as our numerator. So the first observation is that L1 is then an N relative price of a traded asset. So I have that this guy is an QN martingale. So this means under the measure QN, now my stochastic process has zero drift. So this corresponds to the step in the Black-Scholes model, where you say that the drift of the stock is R times S. Yeah? But actually now I'm in this second formulation of the Black-Scholes model, where I look at the drift of F, so this forward F, am arguing that under this measure, this object has drift zero. Okay, so I know the dynamic of L under this measure. Now we proceed in the same step. So now I know the probability distribution of L at the fixing date, L1 of T1. So to derive the probability distribution, we do the same step as in our other derivation. I move to the log normal process. I know the logarithm of L is normal distributed. So from Itô's lemma, I get here this part with the 1/2 sigma squared. Yeah, so this guy comes here from Itô's lemma. And I now know the dynamic of the logarithm of L1. Yeah? So I know that L1 of capital T is normally distributed with mean initial value logarithm of L1 of zero minus 1/2 sigma squared capital T. So instead of the capital T, our fixing is in T1. So I observe now this probability distribution here in T1. Okay. And I have exactly the same task now as before. Calculate the expectation of the maximum of a random variable, which is log normal distributed, or in other words, calculate the expectation of the maximum of the exponential of the random variable that is normal distributed. So we will find the same integral representation. You can go through all the steps, or you go back to our generalized Black-Scholes formula, which tells me immediately how this value looks like. So this value looks like this formula here. Okay, so let's map this to the other formula which we had. Okay, so we are paying in units of M. So we are paying in units of M. So let's take here again the green color for this M. Okay, so this is here in the payoff, the units in which we pay. So it encodes the amount that we pay and it encodes the time at which we pay. So here we pay in units of the zero coupon bond T2. But also in the maximum function, when we have the payment, we pay multiplied with T2 minus T1. So we do not pay one unit. We pay, if it is half a year, just half the amount. So second step, what is the index that we pay? So what is the index where we have the option on? So we pay maximum of F minus K. So this is then here the blue part, the F. Okay, this is the stochastic process that is a martingale under this measure. So I have here my L. So this is the forward rate I observe in zero. And you see that all the other parts of this formula are just the same. So nice derivation. We have an Black-Scholes formula for an option on the interest rate. And we just needed a special choice of the Dubarea, which was associated with the fact that we pay at the end of the period. Okay, so this is associated here with paying at the end of the period. Also, the D plus minus is the same. It's logarithm of F of zero divided by K, plus minus the volatility that appears in our model assumption, times 1/2 times T1, so volatility squared. You see that the volatility parameter is the only model parameter that is left, apart from the initial value, also the zero coupon bond at the end. Okay, so we see that we have three model parameters. So there is here the sigma, the volatility, there is the initial value of the forward rate, and there is the zero coupon bond price at the payment time. So these are my model parameters. And I have then here the product parameter K that is related to the option, and maybe T1, T2 are also product parameters. And you see that this here is a little bit related to how the level of the interest rate curve looks like. So this is what we expect from the interest rate curve. So, and this parameter here, the sigma, is a little bit like the risk. So what we expect with respect to the interest rate curve, how it will change. And it's maybe nice to separate these two effects. The interest rate curve will maybe change often during the day. So this means that here, these two parameters, they change during the day. The interest rate I expect and also the zero coupon bond price, they change. But maybe the volatility, the way how frequent the change is not so often. So this means that if I calculate now the value of the option, the value will change very often, but just because these two guys change. So to separate this effect, it's maybe nicer to calculate from the price using the given interest rates, so using L0 and P, the volatility parameter that corresponds to this price. And hopefully the volatility parameter doesn't change so often. So this technique of not observing the price, but observing a model parameter under the assumption that I plug in for all the other parameters the current observed values. This is very, very, very often used, yeah, and it's then called implied model parameter. Yeah? So the model parameter is implied by the values I observed at the market. Yeah? The value you observed for the interest rate and the value you observe for the price. So you have a map that maps sigma to the value, and you invert this formula. So you do the inversion of the Black-Scholes formula, inversion of the valuation formula, to express something in an implied parameter. So sometimes you find quotes then for options in terms of volatility parameters. So I have here on the slide the value of a digital caplet under the Black-Scholes-like dynamics, under the Black model dynamics. And this formula just comes from differentiating the valuation formula of the caplet. So this is the digital caplet. We had a little lemma above that the value of the digital caplet is minus differentiate the value of the caplet with respect to k. And if you perform this differentiation, you get this nice formula, which looks a little bit like if you differentiate here with respect to k, you just differentiate with respect to this parameter. There's the minus here in front, but also the minus in the lemma. So this minus goes away. So I just have zero coupon bond price times phi of d minus times t2 minus t1. Yeah. Zero coupon bond price times phi of t minus times t2 minus t1. So actually there's an n in front, which is the which is actually the notional. I believe in the formula it was an M because I do not want to confuse it with the numeraire. But if you do this, well, you have to be a little bit careful. There is also a K here. Yeah? You should differentiate D plus minus. But if you do this, the funny thing is that this cancels with the differentiation in the other part. Huh? So the formula is really, really nice. Maybe we can have a small break here. And then I do, you know, then I do the Bachelier model.